Let's talk about mining in space. Neil deGrasse Tyson once said that the first trillionaire will be the person who mines asteroids for resources. But there's more to this than just getting rich. Taking resource extraction into space could take pressure off of the environment on our own planet. It could even be the key to us reaching new planets or even new solar systems. But it's not just easy money out there among the stars. This is a logistical nightmare to say the least. So how do we make it work? Is it even worthwhile? And what do we do with our space resources once we mine them? Let's get into it. The first place that we are going to want to look when scouting for our mining locations in space will be asteroids. They are the closest and most worthwhile resource in our solar system. The surface of the moon or Mars is just not going to be dense enough with the good stuff to be worthwhile. Just the act of developing and manufacturing a mining rig that can go into space is going to be catastrophically expensive. It would probably be the single most expensive project in human history. So the reward needs to be equally high, but we know that asteroids can deliver. Planets are actually the worst places in the solar system to mine because all of the best resources are buried too deep under the surface. When the Earth formed, the force of its gravity pulled all of the heavy metals into the molten core, leaving very few in the surface crust. But over billions of years, asteroids smashed into that crust and deposited their own supply of these metals back into the Earth's composition. So all of the gold, cobalt, nickel, iron, platinum, and other rare but extremely valuable elements in the Earth's crust came from asteroids that impacted after the planet was formed. We've already been able to scout out a few asteroids in our neighborhood that might make for good mining candidates. There's Bennu, for example. This is the asteroid in the solar system that is most likely to smash into the Earth and kill us all sometime in the next 100 years or so. It's made up of mostly iron, which is very useful but not particularly valuable. Bennu is estimated to be worth around $700 million. And that's no small amount of money, but is it worth building an entire space mining industry to go after? Probably not. How about Ryugu? This is an asteroid that the Japanese Space Agency has been studying, and it is now thought to consist of several important resources, including nickel, iron, cobalt, water, nitrogen, and hydrogen. The value of Ryugu would be something around $80 billion, and it's accessible enough that experts believe that after the cost of a mining operation, about $30 billion in profit could be had from the asteroid. That's pretty good. But even if you did have $30 billion, you'd still be nowhere near as rich as Jeff Bezos managed to get, and he's barely even been to space. So what's the point of mining an asteroid if we can't utterly humiliate Jeff in the process, am I right? If we want the Bezos killer, we gotta go for 16 Psyche, possibly the most valuable asteroid in the solar system, and likely also the largest. This one lives in the asteroid belt in between Mars and Jupiter. It's widely believed that Psyche is actually the formed core of a dead planet that somehow lost its outer layers. So remember how we said that all of the metals get pulled into a planet's molten core as the planet forms? That means Psyche is a concentrated mass of heavy metal. It's believed that the majority of the asteroid is nickel and iron, but it should also contain super valuable metals like platinum and gold as well. The estimated value of 16 Psyche is something like $10,000 quadrillion, which is just an unfathomable amount. But that's the dragon that would-be space miners are chasing. One big score that unlocks more wealth than the entire global economy put together. Is that even legal though? Can you own an asteroid? Well, no, you can't. But there is actually something called the United States Space Act that was written in 2015, and it says that American companies are allowed to own the materials that they mine from bodies in space. Now, the obvious problem with this whole scheme being that once we unlock an unlimited supply of resources like nickel, then it stops being rare and by extension stops being valuable. Of course, it's more difficult than that, because while the supply would be abundant, the access to it would still be restricted because it requires flying through space to collect and bring back. Add to that the limitations of carrying capacity of a spaceship. So far, the closest thing we have to a functional interplanetary cargo vehicle is the SpaceX Starship, with an estimated cargo capacity of 100 metric tons. The annual nickel production on Earth in the year 2020 was 2.5 million metric tons, which would equal 25,000 Starship loads of pure nickel per year for asteroid mining to even match Earth mining, which would be, on average, 70 Starship launches per day, every day, on a round trip that would probably take 2 or 3 years to complete. So that's not exactly a scenario that we would call practical. It's a real head-scratcher of a problem and one that we might not be ready to solve just yet. Okay, so we know that we can, at the very least, land probes on asteroids. That's actually been accomplished already. The Japanese Space Agency began their Hayabusa, or Peregrine Falcon, mission in 2003 to explore near-Earth asteroids. Hayabusa 1 landed on the Itokawa asteroid in 2005. This is a fairly small object, at less than 1 kilometer in diameter, and the probe landed on the asteroid and collected samples in the form of tiny grains of asteroidal material, which were returned to Earth aboard the spacecraft on June 13, 2010. And this wasn't the first probe to land on an asteroid, but it was the first to land, take samples, and then come back. The Hayabusa 2 launched in 2014 on a mission to the Ryugu asteroid that we mentioned earlier. Again, the probe surveyed the asteroid, collected samples, and returned them to Earth. The payload from Hayabusa 2 arrived in December 2020. So, can we just scale up these small probe experiments into full-blown resource extraction? Not really. The reason that it's pretty easy to get a probe to an asteroid and make contact is because the probe is super small and lightweight. The kind of deep space probes use ion thrusters, which are great because they only need a small amount of gaseous fuel and a small amount of electricity to fire. They can run easily just from solar panels. But these ion thrusters lack the power output for hard acceleration or deacceleration. So the thrusters have to burn for a very long time to get the probe up to speed, and then burn equally as long to slow it down. And that's fine for a little probe that's in no rush to get anywhere. It's not going to work for an epic mining ship. Just try and imagine the scale of the spaceship that we would need to launch a mining industry on 16 Psyche. It would be humongous, and the weight of it would be unprecedented. It would have to be assembled in orbit, probably. So that's going to need an equally massive rocket engine to burn with enough force to get this ship up to the velocity it needs to cover the distance in a reasonable amount of time. And then on the other end, that engine needs to burn again with the power to bring this whole thing to a stop. When we land a spaceship on Earth, we rely on the atmosphere to handle the majority of the deacceleration energy. But asteroids don't have atmospheres to help with that. And they don't have gravity either, which is another problem. Psyche might have enough mass for microgravity, but it's believed to be just 0.06 meters per second squared. The Earth, by comparison, has a gravity of about 9.8 meters per second squared, depending on what part you measure from. And that's the biggest, most dense asteroid we know. All the others have less gravitational force, which is to say they basically have none. So remember that climactic scene in Armageddon when Bruce Willis has to dramatically pull himself up out of the hole on the surface of the asteroid just in the nick of time to set off the explosion and save the world? Sorry, spoiler alert for a 20-year-old movie, but that would never be the case in real life. Bruce Willis would actually have the opposite problem of struggling to keep himself and stuff from just floating away into space. That's a really big problem for trying to mine an asteroid. The easiest way that we know how to mine rocks on Earth is to drill a long hole, put explosives in, and then set off a huge explosion that breaks up the rock and then we extract the rubble. But if we did that on an asteroid, all the rubble would just shoot straight out into space. Any rock that we break free from the mass of the asteroid will not stick around. So that's just logistical craziness to try and figure out. We'd need some kind of combination of rock crusher and vacuum machine thing. Another crazy idea would be to go out to the asteroid we want and capture it. Like, I doubt we'll have tractor beams in any kind of near future, so I guess we'd be latching onto it with cables or something, and then we bring it back to Earth's orbit. Not too close, obviously, we want to put the asteroid into orbit around the moon. Then we could break it up into small pieces that we could crash into the moon and then process there on the surface, or something like that. So let's assume that we land a mining rig on an asteroid and extract resources without letting them float away and start shipping them back to Earth. Now, how do we get them down here to the surface where we can use them? That's a fun one to think about. So again, SpaceX Starship as an example, because it's the closest thing to a working space vehicle. It can lift off with 100 metric tons of cargo thanks to the most powerful first stage rocket booster ever created. And SpaceX seems to be confident that the second stage Starship can land on the moon and Mars with that amount of weight in it. The gravity on Mars is about one-third the amount that is on Earth, which is why that would make sense. But it seems a little more unlikely that a fully laden Starship could pull off its landing trick on Earth. So if we can't land a spaceship full of rocks, then how do we get them down here? I don't know if anybody actually knows, but it's fun to think about. Maybe we could build a humongous space capsule, like a gigantic version of the one that brings people down to Earth. It could have an epic parachute that's like the size of New York City, and it would land in the ocean and be able to float there. There's obviously a limit on how much weight we can just drop into the ocean, though. Anything big enough to be genuinely useful would probably just cause a giant tsunami wave that would ruin everything, so that's probably a bad idea. How about a space elevator? Like the same idea as a grain elevator, but working in the reverse direction, and obviously big enough to extend from the Earth's surface all the way into orbit. I guess at a certain point it would probably fall over, though, from being too tall, unless the foundation was like the size of Mexico. Okay, also a bad idea. But I would love to hear a theory that would actually work, because in my head, it kind of seems impossible, though I know there's gotta be a way. But because of all of that, it's become pretty widely accepted that if we are going to extract resources in space, then we are going to have to use them in space as well. And that presents a whole new range of problems and opportunities. One easy win is water. We're sure that there is plenty of water available inside asteroids in the form of ice. Water is pretty heavy, and therefore it's not easy to get from the Earth into space. Water is not only vital to drink, but astronauts also need it to rehydrate their space food. And when we're looking at potential designs for a radiation shield that could be used in deep space exploration, water is actually a really good element to use as our insulator. Even just for use within Earth's orbit and for missions to the moon, it's probably more cost-effective to source water in space than it is to try and launch it in a rocket. Just getting the equivalent of one bottle of water into orbit can cost as much as $43,000. There's a dwarf planet called Ceres that is mixed in with the asteroid belt in between Mars and Jupiter. Imaging from the Hubble Space Telescope tells us that there is probably more water contained within that planet than there is on the entire planet Earth. It should be fairly easy to extract the water as well. There's a process called optical mining where we could concentrate heat from the sun to essentially bake the water vapor out of the rocks and collect it. But water mining on asteroids isn't exactly as exciting as digging up space rocks, but it's honestly probably the most practical thing we can do out there. Unless, of course, we want to start building spaceships in space. Which is exactly what we want to do, but as a society, we're probably still a long way away from that one. Even in the eternally optimistic world of Star Trek, the Utopia shipyards around Mars didn't open until the 24th century, and by that point, warp drive and first contact with aliens was old news. If we're going to keep up with that timeline, then we're going to need warp drive in about 40 years from now. So, a child born today could still grow up to be an alcoholic rocket scientist who builds a lightspeed ship in a post-World War III missile silo. But it's unlikely. That was an inside joke, I apologize if you're lost. If mining in deep space ever is going to be a thing, then who's going to do it? Elon Musk is surprisingly not very excited by the whole matter. In an October 2003 video, Musk described space mining as, quote, pretty bogus, stating that if you calculated how much it takes to bring the raw material back to Earth, the economics don't make sense. If he's changed his mind on that in the meantime, then I can't find anywhere that he said it publicly. Elon's master plan for humanity, in this century at least, is a self-sustaining civilization on Mars. That's what he sees as the trillion-dollar opportunity. There are at least two large firms that were founded in the last 10 years for the purpose of deep space mining. The first asteroid company, Planetary Resources, was founded in 2012, and within a year of that, the US company Deep Space Industries also popped up. Or at least that's what I'm told. At the time of doing this research, I can't get either of their companies' websites to load. One comes up with no security certificate and Chrome doesn't want to load it, and the other just goes nowhere and times out. So that's how well that's going. But what do you guys think? Space mining, is it bogus or the key to unlimited wealth? And if it is possible, then how do we get it down here to the surface? Drop your theories in the comment section below. Please don't forget to give this video a thumbs up today. That really means a lot to us, and we really appreciate your support. We've got two more videos on the screen for you to check out. They're pretty awesome. Subscribe to this channel for more videos and ring the notification bell as well. It's a lot of work, I know, but it'll be worth it. Thanks for watching the video, and I'll see you in the next one.